says romanticism says modern art. That is to say, intimacy, spirituality, color, yearning towards infinity.
In Constable's paintings of the English countryside, the romantic's rediscovery of nature results in work that springs directly from observation and experience of the sky and landscape. In so doing, it refreshes a tradition that had become academic and studio-bound. In his Raft of the Medusa, talisman picture of romantic art, the young painter Jericho gives us an extreme version of a key romantic theme: the frailty of civilization and the basic savagery of man. The German artist Caspar David Friedrich paints vast panoramas infused with a kind of psychic melancholy. The figures in these lonely landscapes contemplate prospects that suggest a spiritual rather than a physical distance. With Friedrich, we glimpse infinity. William Blake regarded his work as transcriptions of celestial visions. His first visionary experience came to him at the age of 4, when the face of God appeared at his father's window. In Blake's art, the supernatural and the fantastic, both highly prized and sought after by the romantics, occur as an everyday part of life. Romantic artists, the supernatural is a reflection of the sexual or barbaric reality that lurks just beneath the skin of civilized man. The sleep of reason brings forth monsters. The title of this etching, one of a series of caprichos by the Spanish artist Francisco Goya, fits better the scourges and terrors of our own century than the people and manners usually portrayed in the painting of the 18th century. Yet this image, with its prophetic title, was first published in the last years of the so-called century of reason. It is a token for the dramatic developments in the visual arts brought about by the complex of ideas and feelings subsequently dubbed Romanticism. The world of classical painting, structured, ordered, and instructive, above all reasonable, is dissolved in light exploded by color, subverted by images of cruelty and horror. The academies of art lose their grip on standards of quality and taste, and from here on, the individual takes over. The three great romantic painters are Goya, Delacroix, and Turner. Their art has nothing in common except its passionate and direct appeal to our emotions, its upending of all the previous notions of what makes a picture, and a profound and underlying pessimism. In this new world in which man is no longer master of his universe, the present is disturbing, the future unknown. In the work of each of these artists, we can chart the emergence of a motif that develops the power of an obsession. For Delacroix, it is blood. In this early painting, Delacroix uses a dramatic theatricality to focus our attention on the newly spilt blood of the doomed doge Marino Faliero. The color, movement, and drama of the picture are in themselves romantic, but so is the theme and setting. The title is taken from the verse drama by Lord Byron, and the action takes place in Venice. In his own lifetime, Delacroix was linked to the tiger, a creature of great force and magnetism and malevolent power. Traces of all these things we can still read in photographs of the artist, who was known to frequent the Paris Zoo at feeding time, gazing with rapt attention on the spectacle of the great cats eating. Born half a century after Goya,
In 1798, Delacroix is the archetype romantic. And it is Delacroix who, when his friend Géricault dies tragically at 32, continues his search for an art that is dynamic, bold, and violently contemporary. Liberty Leading the People is one of the landmarks of the 19th century, and it places Delacroix in the leadership of the modern school. Rumored to be the illegitimate son of Talleyrand, whose features and bearing he resembles, Delacroix grows up at the home of his apparent father, an ambassador and civil servant. All his life, he aspired to distinctions and official honors, yet his work was revolutionary. His troubled relationship to the French Academy is drawn out over 20 years. Delacroix was in public life an aristocrat and a dandy. But Baudelaire had no doubt that he was the most fascinating and most vital artist of his age.
What makes Delacroix the true painter of the 19th century is the unique and persistent melancholy with which all his works are imbued, and which is revealed in his choice of subjects, the expression on his faces, the gestures, and the color. Delacroix loves Shakespeare and Dante, two other great painters of human anguish. Look at the picture. You will assist at the celebration of some painful mystery.
The house that was also his studio in the Place Fürstenberg, Paris, is now the Delacroix Museum. Whereas the paintings are full of fire and bravura, the studio is full of evidence of Delacroix's cool analysis of the tools and motifs of his art. Baudelaire noted the combination of verve and control that still marks the relics of his studio. Delacroix was passionately in love with passion and coldly determined to seek the means to express that passion in visual form. It is to this unceasing preoccupation that must be attributed his quest into the relationship of colors, into the quality of colors, and his curiosity about the chemical properties of color. Delacroix's paintings are pitched on opposing tensions, on paradox and conflict. Like Byron and like Baudelaire, Delacroix's work at once celebrates and agonizes over the duality of man, trapped between earth and sky, mortality and infinity. In one of his last great paintings, Delacroix determines to leave to mankind a belief in the ultimate victory of the spirit. It is still an image of violent conflict. In the Church of Saint-Sulpice, he paints Jacob wrestling with the angel. The last painting of the English painter Turner is also an image of extreme conflict. The struggle of man to survive the force of a wild and storm-wrecked sea. Ruskin on Turner's Seas.
Few people have ever seen the effect on the sea of a powerful gale continued without intermission for 3 or 4 days and nights. And to those who have not, I believe it must be unimaginable. Not from the mere force or size of surge, but from the complete annihilation of the limit between sea and air. Suppose the effect of the first sunbeam sent from above to show this annihilation, and you have one of the very grandest statements of sea motion, mist, and light that has ever been put on canvas, even by Turner. Of course, it was not understood.
The painter obsessed with light was born in the dark. Turner was born above his father's barber shop in Maiden Lane, near the old Covent Garden vegetable market. He spent his life forever seeking subtler ways of transposing light,
and the effects of light on land and water into paint. At the start of his career, Turner was influenced by the work of Claude Lorrain, already much loved by the strata of English society who collected paintings. The link with Lorrain won for these early Turners a considerable popularity among English art lovers, nostalgic for Italy and happy to find in a modern artist the same qualities they knew and loved in the master. Official success, the patronage of collectors, and the eagerness of visitors in his dusty studio, Turner lived a chaotic personal life. He never married, and had long periods when, seeking anonymity, he would live in boarding houses under false names. He traveled a great deal, both in Britain and in Europe, seeking out the scenery that would connect with his ambitions for his paintings. All of his life, Turner was a passionate student of nature, but of nature in her wilder, grander aspects. In his paintings, we are rarely presented simply with a record of landscape, of cityscape. There is invariably the suggestion of the presence of man, and the scenes with which Turner presents us carry in them a meditation on the theme of the mortality of man, in contrast to the immortality of nature. In Scotland, the Alps, or in Venice, the great theme that runs through all his work is the vain struggle of man against the elements and against time. The destructive fury of nature when pitted against the works of men. The critic John Ruskin, Turner's great champion, uncovers the theme of ruin, disillusion, and death that underlies these glorious paintings.
As the strength of men to Giorgione, to Turner, their weakness and vileness were alone visible. They themselves unworthy or ephemeral, their work despicable or decayed. In the Venetian's eye, all beauty depended on man's presence and pride. In Turner's, on the solitude he had left and the humiliation he had suffered. And thus the fate and issue of all his work were determined at once. He must be a painter of the strength of nature. There was no beauty elsewhere than in that. He must paint also the labor and sorrow and passing away of men. This was the great human truth visible to him. Also their sorrow, ruin of all their glorious work, passing away of their thoughts and their honor, mirage of pleasure, fallacy of hope, gathering of weed on temple step, gaining of wave on deserted strand, weeping of the mother for the children, desolate by her breathless firstborn in the streets of the city, desolate by her last son slain among the beast of the field. And their death, the unconquerable specter, still flitting among the forest trees at twilight, rising ribbed out of the sea sand. White, a strange Aphrodite out of the sea foam, stretching its grey, cloven wings among the clouds, turning the light of their sunsets into blood.
In Delacroix's great painting, Massacre at Chios, the counterpoint is between barbarous man triumphant and civilized man dying. The theme is romantic, but the subject was urgently contemporary. It is based on an incident in 1821, when an army of 10,000 Turks landed on the Greek island of Chios, and for a month wreaked havoc on the defenseless populace.
It is only possible to speak in the language and the spirit of one's time. One must be understood by those who listen, and especially by oneself. Make Achilles a Greek. But good God, did Homer himself do so? He made Achilles a man of his own time. Those who had known the real Achilles were long since dead.
Articulate and wryly observant, Delacroix kept a record of his life in one of the most extraordinary artists' journals ever written. When in 1832 Delacroix journeyed to Morocco, the impact that the country made on him is recorded in the pages of his journal as well as in the pages of his sketchbook.
In Barbary, you see the natural, which is always disguised in our country. The precious and rare influence of the sun gives everything a penetrating life. Here, the notion of glory has no meaning. Languorous ease is the order of the day, and there is nothing to prove that it is not the ideal state for human beings. One encounters beauty at every street corner. It's almost heart-rending, and makes one feel that painting, or rather the desire to paint, is the height of madness.
Painting The Jewish Wedding is a monument to that rare privilege, an invitation to a wedding in a Moroccan home. The color and light of the ceremony impressed themselves on him, but so did the ritual significance of the occasion.
The wedding ceremonies here are a completely different matter to those of most European people. At home, there is nothing colder. Whereas here, in the case of Oriental people and of Jews, who live under strains which tighten the bonds that unite them, the big events in family life are marked by ritual acts linked to ancient customs.
Even more unusual was Delacroix's feat in gaining entrance to a Muslim's harem. Here he spent 2 days working.
In a state of wild excitement, which large bowls of sherbet and dishes of exotic fruit did little to subdue, the lovely human gazelles soon got used to my presence and hardly noticed as I busily made sketches, mostly pastels. This is woman as I understand her, not thrown into the life of the world, but withdrawn at its heart, at its most secret, delicious, and moving fulfillment.
Thank you. Delacroix's own duality between reason and imagination, reality and dream, led to his admiration of Shakespeare. Hamlet and Horatio in the Graveyard by Delacroix. Of this painting, Delacroix notes,
Hamlet, in the midst of his grief and his schemes for revenge, indulged in buffoonery with Polonius and the students, and amused himself with the actors.
Delacroix's immense admiration for Goethe and his love of Faust led him to do a series of illustrations for the book. Illustrations which Goethe said surpassed even his own understanding of the work. By his own dual nature, Delacroix belongs to the romantic family of anxious, unquiet heroes. He too could lay claim to the famous phrase of Goethe's,
because I am a man, that is to say, a combatant.
Delacroix's later paintings continue the theme of chaos, with images of a civilization smoking and burning, the slaughter of mankind.
All this resembles a terrible hymn composed in honor of fatality and irremediable pain.
In the death of Sardanapalus, its hero, inspired by Byron's poem, is a disillusioned Assyrian king who gathers around him all his treasures, concubines, horses, and precious jewels, and sets fire to them all to escape the world's madness. Like Sardanapalus, the imagination of Delacroix places the artist himself at the center of his seething world. Delacroix is Sardanapalus, sitting enthroned at the summit of his funeral pyre of vanities, with the sad and heavy look of a wild yet dying man. For Delacroix, the emblem of life is blood. For Turner, it is the sea. The self-educated barber's son never acquired the social ease and grace, the elegant style, or the aristocratic confidence of Delacroix. And if Delacroix had the confidence to tell all, Turner had another kind of confidence. It is the self-sufficiency or genius which enables Turner to tell nothing. Instead, Turner awakens poetic emotion by creating paintings as subtle and as suggestive as music and poetry. Ruskin on the sumptuous mysteries of Turner's Venice.
Dreamlike and dim, but glorious, the unnumbered palaces lift their shafts out of the hollow sea. Their sculptural arabesques and purple marble, fading farther and fainter, league beyond league, lost in the light of distance. Detail after detail, thought beyond thought, You find and feel them through the radiant mystery. Inexhaustible as indistinct, beautiful but never all revealed. Giving out of that indistinctness and through that confusion, the perpetual newness of the infinite and the beautiful.
Rain, steam, and speed. Turner celebrates the power of the machine and the power of the elements, reconciling two worlds that for many of the romantics could never be joined. On the night of the 16th of October, 1834, the Houses of Parliament catch on fire. Turner, hearing of the mighty conflagration, rushes to record this spectacular example of a furious nature devouring the works of man. Delacroix, in his journal, observes,
"What moves men of genius, or rather what inspires their work, is not new ideas, but their obsession with the idea that what has already been said is still not enough."
He could have been describing the 60 years Turner spent exploring every kind of landscape, every kind of weather, every kind of sea, and always pushing to the extremity of his art. Turner died on a dark winter's day in December 1851. The winter sun broke through for a few moments, and on his deathbed, he is reputed to have turned towards the light. Goya precedes by several decades both Turner and Delacroix, but he dominates romantic painting by his singular genius. He was part of no school, no tendency, no group of artists, and the image that best sums up his passionate but bleak, despairing, angry art is the image of the quicksand. In a late painting, Goya faces us with an image that is empty of almost everything except fear and despair. A dog, as it is swallowed up in sand, gazes up at a bare heaven. The effect is tragically comic, in a way paralleled only in our own century. He was born in 1746 near Saragossa. His father was a master gilder and seems to have remained poor all his life. It was a background where talent, even genius, could have easily been starved out. What was needed to survive was tenacity, will, and the infinite patience of the peasants of Aragon. The house where Goya was born still exists, a monument to the painter of the most humble kind. His revolutionary spirit, independence, and will, Goya was extremely adept at the art of politics. Twice refused admission to the Academy, he finally submitted his picture of Christ on the Cross, a painting not easily rejected in Catholic Spain. His marriage to the sister of the painter Bayeux apparently secured him a commission of tapestries. The large pictures show his love of life, and especially village life. Only in one of these cartoons, The Mannequin, in which young girls are tossing a limp man dummy into the air, is there any hint that inside this apparently life-loving artist is a darker spirit? The success of these cartoons for tapestries led to his appointment as court painter. Almost immediately, Goya became the preferred painter of Spain's high society. He paints portraits, but he pays no compliments. Marie Louise in her black mantilla. Ferdinand VII in his royal mantle. They look like desperately ordinary people who have borrowed their sumptuous clothes for the occasion. The court spent the summers at Saint-Idelphonse, in a castle which was a copy of Versailles. Until this time in Goya's career, his paintings reflect none of the romantic themes which are beginning to surface elsewhere in Europe. But his last portrait, The Family of Charles IV, captures the mordant luxury of the royal family. In the background, the painter himself is witness to a family grouping that will become history. The artist's face is noble, and the noble faces are pathetic in their banality. However much the artist may claim to live in that self-sufficient region of his art, whose only boundaries are inspiration, genius, and will, the artist is still attached to the earth, and to that particular part of the earth from whence he came. The flavor and the texture of nationality are inescapable. Even in exile, the artist brings with him the place where he was raised. Goya would die outside Spain, in exile in France during the last years of his life. But to know Goya, to understand the work, one must enter into Spain. Goya's Spain is also Cervantes' Spain, the creator of Don Quixote. Comic, satiric, grotesque, and tragic, all at once. Goya's humanity is rooted in his willingness to confront man at his most naked, at his most bestial. He is the first painter to offer us pictures that have no hiding place from horror. Goya paints lunatics in the madhouse, cannibals, witches. At 50, it's almost as though Goya will become the knight of sad countenance. For a year, he suffered from a mysterious illness which nearly killed him. At the end of it, he was left completely deaf. Cut off from sound, the element which represents reason, Goya was persecuted by taunting voices. the Caprichos, his great cycle of etchings, Goya explains,
"The world is a masquerade. The face, the clothing, the voice is all feigned. All wish to appear what they are not. We all fool each other, and nobody knows himself."
This desperation and misery, this sense of human mystery, enters into his later portraits. Bats, cats, owls scratch and claw their way into his work. The self-portrait, intended to be the frontispiece for the Caprichos cycle, bears the inscription,
"The sleep of reason brings forth monsters."
This line is a prophetic description of the entire Romantic movement, which would turn its back on the age of reason and pay the Goya-esque price of nightmare, fear, and suffering. The Caprichos are a savage attack on the church and its Inquisition, on a backward and superstitious Spain, and on a feeble king. Although Goya had lost his hearing, he had not lost his talent for political irony. He presented the Caprichos to the king as a gift. The surreal is punctuated by utter realism. In his famous painting, The Maya Desnuda, Goya captures the lady's body with an intimacy then unparalleled in art, and establishes a precedent for the realistically painted nudes of the 19th century. Nowhere is the romantic obsession with death and with the heroic futility more perfectly located than in the arena of the bullfight. Since his youth, when Goya wandered across Spain with a company of strolling bullfighters, the painter had been obsessed by the festival, half burlesque and half bloody, where in the midst of laughter, blood streams. Was able to see in the arena of the bullfight this macabre mix of festival and death, the ultimate tapestry of Spanish philosophy. Life is seen as a dangerous festival that ends in death. The essence of the terrible Spanish irony is the fierce determination to die gracefully and happily. Goya, who signs his letters Francisco de los Toros, Francisco of the Bulls. Goya, whose strong, square body is a metaphor for the bulls, and whose deafness breeds in him a voiceless anger. The painter cannot resist the lethal attraction of the corrida, the attraction of the deadly dance of the exasperation of life. It is the last convulsion which precedes death, the triumph over fear, which fascinates Goya. He knows that the Matatoros, the killers of bulls, are in all men the killers of mankind. Only a man who knows the random atrocities of peace can truly understand the atrocities of war. In 1808, the King of Spain abdicated, and Napoleon sent his armies to take over the country. In spite of being a court painter, Goya welcomed a revolution in Spain. But he quickly realized that this was no revolution to welcome. The French armies behaved like savage invaders, carrying out massacres in the middle of the night, murdering the opponents of the revolution. Goya's devastating series, The Disasters of War, witnesses the resistance of the Spanish people. But disasters are not the chronicles of a loyal patriot. They are a violent indictment of the follies of war. It is not Napoleon's army that Goya represents, but a permanent army of executioners. And their victims are not Spanish peasants, but are eternal victims. To feel that they are different in kind from the blood-crazed figures who string them up, slice them up, or tip them into holes in the earth. Their heads snarl and sneer, even though they no longer belong to bodies. We are all potential victims, all potential murderers. The condemnation is universal. In the same way, Goya's painting, The 3rd of May, 1808, is not merely a piece of anti-war propaganda, but a portrait of hopelessness. The painting speaks not of death as the final dignity, but as death, the final absurdity. Deprived of sound, Goya began to see beyond the surface, to penetrate the soul, and to bring the irrational into focus. Old and lonely, he had outlived his wife and many of his 19 children. Goya, at the age of 73, began to cover the walls of his house with paintings. The house, called the House of the Deaf Man, was the canvas for his last visions. These pictures explore a world of darkness and superstition and deceit that few artists have ever dared to enter. They are ghastly and baleful and unrelentingly bleak visions. Even at their most supernatural, the black paintings never allow us to doubt that what they confront us with is horribly familiar. This is painting that has absolutely no justification in the traditional ground of art. That of decorating palaces and apartments. This is art that makes visible the unvarnished, unpalatable truth. It is not 18th century art. It is modern art. The paintings of the mid-18th century depict a world designed to please the taste of wealthy patrons and to bolster their sense of power, as in this painting of Mr. and Mrs. Andrews by Gainsborough. It's a solid, confident world of possessions. Romantic art confronts us with a world where nothing is certain except the fragility of that attempt at order called civilization. This is the beginning of modern art. The paintings of Goya, Delacroix, and Turner dissolve the solid certainties of the old world and prize open the way to a different kind of art, For each, the key was an image of eternal conflict.